number 14. Revelation chapter 3, verse number 14. I'm going to read from the King James Version of the Bible. Revelation chapter 3, verse number 14. And I read in your hearing today the word of God, Jesus himself speaking. He says, "And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot." In other words, I wish you were cold or hot. Verse 16. "So then, because thou art lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, in white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent." Verse 20. "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches." Today we preach on the seventh and final church, Laodicea, the lukewarm church. Laodicea, the lukewarm church. Let's talk to the Lord. God bless us now. Have your way in this place, Lord. Speak over the airwaves, the internet, over the television waves right now. And God, I pray that your power be made manifest to your people, all your people who view. Speak through this preacher. And I pray that, God, souls will be touched, hearts will be pricked, and people will make a decision to make a change for thee. Forgive me of my sins, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Laodicea, the lukewarm church. We've come now to the seventh and the final church of the churches in Revelation. We have preached on Ephesus, the working church. We have preached on Smyrna, the faithful church. We have preached on Pergamos, the compromising church. We have preached on Thyatira, the adulterous church. We have preached on Sardis, the dead church. We have preached on Philadelphia, the enduring church. But now we've come to Laodicea, the lukewarm church. And out of the seven letters to the seven churches, this letter is probably the most popular one, but it is also the most or the harshest one. Now let me remind you that these letters were written to the church, the household of faith, the body of Christ, followers of Jesus, believers of God. And so while there may or could have been some unbelievers in the mix, Jesus is addressing believers in this text. And he's addressing a city that is rich. Laodicea was so rich that when it was hit by an earthquake in AD 60 and the entire city was virtually destroyed, but when the Roman Empire offered to rebuild the city for the people were so rich, they said to the government, "We don't need your money. We'll build our own city back by our own selves." I guess they operated by the philosophy that God bless the child who has his own. Do I have a witness in this place? Laodicea had a renowned medical school that was known for the development of eye salve to treat blindness. There was also a wool industry in Laodicea where they made beautiful black wool. But their wealth, the wealth in Laodicea, came from banking. They were, if you will, the Wall Street of Asia Minor. Laodicea was rich. Laodicea was wealthy. But their problem was not their wealth, but what their wealth had done to them. Let me remind you today, before I get too deep into the word, that just because someone is wealthy, that doesn't mean they're a bad person. Some people think that if you're rich, you're not holy, you're not blessed. But I'm here to remind somebody that Abraham had money and he was blessed. Job had money and he was blessed. The Bible never said that money was the root of all evil. The Bible says that the love of money is the root of all evil. But don't you forget that just because someone is wealthy doesn't mean they're blessed either. You see, I know a whole lot of folk that man would consider blessed because they're rich or wealthy. But somebody knows you can be rich and still be cursed. You can be rich and still go to hell. And let me also remind you that just because you're poor doesn't mean you're blessed either. I know a whole lot of folk who are poor and cursed. You can be poor and go to hell too. Do I have a witness in this place? The question of being blessed or not is whether we hold our wealth as a stewardship from God to be used for his glory, the good of others, and the work of the gospel. God honors faithfulness. Let me say that one more time. God honors faithfulness. That's why there are some people who make less than you but have more than you because they're faithful. That's why so many millionaires lose all their money, because they didn't return a tithe. They didn't give an offering. And as a result, they didn't have God's protection. And because they didn't have God's protection, they inherited crooked lawyers, crooked accountants, crooked financial planners, crooked tax collectors, crooked friends, crooked husbands, crooked wives, crooked co-workers. They inherited crooked folk all around them who were just leeching off of them. Newsflash. Some folk are in your crowd and they are leeches. They are parasites. A parasite wants to cling to something and suck everything out of it to survive. There are some people that want to cling to you just so they can see what they will get out of you. You see, when you have cheese, the rats come out. And the more cheese you get, the more rats you're going to attract. I wish somebody knew what I was talking about. Understand, Laodicea was rich, but that didn't mean it was blessed. Laodicea was situated on a major highway, located about 40 miles southeast of the city of Philadelphia and about 100 miles east of Ephesus. It was the leading commercial city in that area. Now, you need to also know that Laodicea had two sister cities. Hierapolis was one of those sister cities, and Colossae was the other sister city. Hierapolis was located 6 miles north of Laodicea and was known for its hot water. Hot water, as you know, is healing water. Hot water, as you know, is soothing water. Hot water is medicinal in nature. But then Colossae, which was located about 10 miles southeast of Laodicea, was known for its cold water. And cold water, you know, is pure and refreshing. But Laodicea, unlike Hierapolis and unlike Colossae, Laodicea had awful water. But why did Laodicea have awful water? Because of its wealth, Laodicea grew so fast that the two nearby rivers were unable to supply its need for water. So engineers had to develop an aqueduct system, if you will, for Laodicea to receive its water. And by the time this water reached Laodicea, it was lukewarm. It was neither hot nor cold. So it didn't have medicinal qualities. Neither did it have refreshing, pure qualities. It was lukewarm. It was good for nothing. Jesus tells the church at Laodicea that they had become just like their water, lukewarm and good for nothing. Jesus said, you're neither cold, which is refreshing, nor are you hot, which is healing, but your temperature is lukewarm. In other words, you're straddling the fence. You're in the river and you're on the bank. You're neither hot nor cold. you're lukewarm. Your taste is terrible. The aqueduct water system is not working, and there's nothing left for me to do but to spit you out. But how had this church become lukewarm? How had its spiritual flavor become so awful? Well, there are three ways, and I'm going to share them with you. Three reasons they became lukewarm. Number one, the church at Laodicea was indifferent. Now remember, they had no viable water source. Hot water was piped in from the north at Hierapolis, and cold water came from the south of Colossae. And so by the time the water reached Laodicea, it was neither hot nor cold. And Jesus is saying that the lives of the Laodicean church members mirrored the water that they drank. They weren't hot, which is they weren't on fire for the Lord. They weren't cold, which means they weren't spiritually dead. But they were lukewarm, which means they weren't completely cold. They were attending church, but they weren't hot either, because they had no zeal for the Lord and no desire to live for the Lord. They were a miserable temperature of lukewarm. They were satisfied with their church, and they had no desire to change. And this is a good description of the church today. This is a good description of the universal church today. Too often, the church comes together on a regular basis with no desire to really serve the Lord. Their attitude is, this is their church. They have no desire to change. They're just going through the motions. We are no longer moved by the sacrifice of Christ. The redemption of souls or the wicked state of the world. I mean, let's be honest today. Let's be transparent. Let's get real today. When was the last time you were moved by the message of an old familiar hymn? When was the last time you wept over Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me? When was the last time you were overwhelmed by the power of the 23rd Psalms? When was the last time you felt the joy of God just because you were able to get up on Sabbath morning, put on some clothes, come out of the house when we weren't under coronavirus, get to church, get out of your car, step into the sanctuary and walk up before Christ? When was the last time you rejoiced in the depths of your heart? Not because you heard a great sermon or listened to a great song or came to a great church, but because you know a great Savior. Enjoy a great hope and serve a mighty God. Are we flunking the test because we're too familiar with the material? More concerned about tradition than truth. More caught up in formality than spirituality. More concerned about custom than creativity. More concerned about policy than people. More concerned about do's and don'ts than deliverance. More concerned about the way it used to be than the way it ought to be. The praise goals of God has for us are often, too often, arrested and handcuffed by tradition and the status quo. We've learned as much about God as we think we need to learn. We're happy and content to be just left alone, going through the motions week after week. No growth, no development, no change, no power, no nothing, just going through the motions. Going through another cycle of prayer meetings, another cycle of church anniversaries, youth days, senior adult days, children's days, education days, revivals, revelation seminars, communion services, just going through the motions. Singing the same songs, hearing the same sermons, praying the same prayers, reciting the same testimonies, going through the motions, unresponsive to God's call, unmoved by God's claim, and unchanged by God's Spirit. No Holy Ghost fire, no Pentecostal zeal, no enthusiasm, no energy, no excitement, just going through the motions. We don't want to take any risks because being safe is easy. It's not hard work. Do what we always have done, but you'll never see new oceans unless you have the courage to lose sight of the shore. Only dead fish go with the flow. You're neither hot nor cold. You're neither on fire for the Lord, nor are you dead for the Lord. Just lukewarm, indifferent, apathetic, unconcerned, unmoved. Lukewarm, The lukewarm church argues about with each other about petty things. What color should the carpet be? How should the deacons walk in? Should we play drums or not in church? What time should church start? What color should the ushers wear? The lukewarm church because some come so wrapped up in their predictable service and their traditions that there is no room left for God's blessings. So what does Jesus say? He says, I have no more use for you. And he spits you out. Have you ever been offered something to drink? You didn't know what it was, but you were offered to drink it. And when you drank it, you immediately spat it out because it tasted so bad. It made you sick. That's what Jesus is saying to us here. He's saying, Laodicea, you taste so bad, I have to spit you out. The word here for spit can also be translated vomit. And when you vomit, my friends, you are sick. And there are too many Laodicean churches making Jesus sick. Empty praise makes him sick. Empty, woeful, and unenergized worship makes him sick. Singing that sounds good but doesn't involve the heart makes him sick. Lack of commitment makes him sick. Lack of evangelism and witness makes him sick. Laziness makes him sick. Complacency makes him sick. Complaining makes him sick. Pleasure preaching that pleases people instead of glorifying God, edifying the people, and persuading sinners to change makes him sick. Church that is more concerned about stuff than it is about salvation makes him sick. Churches that prey on people instead of praying for people make him sick. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to make Jesus sick. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be a part of a church that makes Jesus sick, that turns God's stomach. I don't ever want to turn God's stomach. I don't want God to vomit me out. I don't want God to spit me out. I don't want to be indifferent. But then number two, Laodicea was lukewarm because the people had become arrogant. Look at verse number 17. Jesus says in the text, you say you're rich and increase with goods and have need of nothing. Now stop there. The operative word here is you say. I wish I had time, but I'm going to come back to that in a minute. Say. Now, remember, Laodicea is a wealthy city. They refused Rome's help in rebuilding it after the earthquake hit. They were arrogant people. They had all they needed and weren't interested in help or input from anybody else. But while they were financially wealthy, they were spiritually bankrupt. They were arrogant, haughty, conceited, big-headed, proud. And let me remind you that God hates pride. The Bible says pride goeth before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. And don't get it twisted, because a lot of people say they're confident, not prideful, but you better know the difference. If we ever accomplish anything in this life, it's the result of what Jesus has done for us and through us. I'm very clear in my ministry. God has blessed me to be able to do a lot of things. God has been able to use me, and I'm grateful to do a lot of things. But I'm also clear, it's not anything of what I've done, but it's all about what he's done. Don't get the big head. Just as soon as we get something, my brothers and sisters, God can take it away. We are nothing without God. Let me say that again. I said we are nothing without God. We are like macaroni without cheese. We are like spaghetti without sauce. We are like collard greens without cornbread. We are like peanut butter without jelly. We are like fish without chips. If we're from Jamaica, we're like rice without peas. If we're from Trinidad, we're like peas without rice. Without God, we are nothing. Don't you get the big head. Folk talking about, I'm a good person. I'm a good church member. I do more good things than bad things. I don't really sin. I'm better than most. I know the Bible. I know the spirit of prophecy. I know the commandments. But do you know Jesus? It's not about what you know that's going to save you, but it's all about who you know that's going to save you. Stop being arrogant. Let me say it again. Stop being arrogant. Just because you're an Adventist doesn't make you better than somebody else. Stop being arrogant. Just because you're a Baptist, Catholic, Methodist, Lutheran, Presbyterian, Church of God in Christ, don't think you're better than anybody else. All of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All of us are as sheep gone to the slaughter. All of us, our righteousness in God's sight is filthy rags. All of us are sinners saved by grace. If it weren't for the grace of God, where would we be? If it had not been for the Lord on my side, where would I be? Let me tell you something. A lot of people are going to miss out on heaven because of arrogance. Three surprises when we get to heaven. Those you thought wouldn't be there will be there. Those you thought would be there won't be there. And if you're like me, Lord, thank you, I'm there. Are you hearing what I'm saying? When we get to judgment day, God's not going to ask us what kind of car we drove. But he'll ask us how many people we drove who didn't have transportation. God won't ask us the square footage of our house, but he'll ask us how many people we welcomed into our homes. God won't ask us about the fancy clothes we had in our closets, but God will ask us how many clothes we helped the needy with. God won't ask us how many material possessions we had, but he'll ask us if they dictated our lives. God won't ask us how high our salary was, but he'll ask us if we compromised our character to obtain the salaries. God won't ask us how many promotions we received, but he'll ask us how we promoted others. God won't ask us what our job titles were, but he'll ask us if we performed our jobs to the best of our abilities. God won't ask us what we did to help ourselves, but he will ask us what we did to help others. God won't ask us what neighborhood we lived in, but he'll ask us how we treated our neighbors. God won't ask us the color of our skin, but he will ask us about the content of our character. God won't ask us how many times our deeds matched our words, but he'll ask us how many times they didn't. Don't be arrogant. Don't get the big head. Don't be self-righteous, because just as quick as you come up, God can take you down. And don't think that because you've joined the church that you received an automatic insurance policy that gained you automatic entrance into the pearly gates. Just like some people on the street gonna be lost, it's gonna be some church folk lost. Laodicea, stop being arrogant. Our spiritual position and work we need to accomplish for the Lord are not justified by the buildings we sit up in, the clothes we wear, or the money in our building funds. Our service to the Lord isn't about our finances. It's all about him. Let me tell you something in the name of Jesus. I pray we never get to the point in this church that we feel we've arrived and we don't see the need to press on or improve. Higher, still higher is God's ideal for his children. Talking about I'm rich, increase with goods, and have need of nothing. No, you need Jesus. We're not to seek money. We're to seek Jesus. The word says in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. God doesn't mind you having things, but he does mind things having you. Don't be arrogant. But then the third point. The third reason that the church at Laodicea is lukewarm is their ignorance. So first, it's their indifference. Second, it's their arrogance. Third, it's their ignorance. What am I talking about? Go back to verse 17. Revelation chapter 3, verse number 17, the word of God says, because thou sayest, not somebody else, but you saying, I am rich and increase with goods and have need of nothing. That word again, sayest. You say, not somebody else, but you say you're rich. You say you're increased with goods. You say you have need of nothing. But then Jesus finishes it. And knowest not, you don't even know that you're wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Laodicea, Jesus says. Laodicea, you think you're all that and then some. But you don't even realize you're pitiful and pathetic. You see, their perception and their reality were totally different. They thought all was well, but Jesus saw a much different point of view. They were proud, but Jesus said they were wretched, miserable, and in need of pity. They were wealthy, but they were actually poor and spiritually bankrupt. They thought they looked fine, but they were blind with no spiritual vision. They had the highest fashion of the day, but they were naked, uncovered before God and unclothed in his righteousness. And that's just like us today. That's just like Laodicea today. We think we're doing something and we're doing nothing. We think we're singing and we sound a mess. We think we're preaching and our sermons are a mess. We think we're dressing and we look a mess. We think we're cooking and our food tastes a mess. We're talking about stuff we don't even know what we're talking about. Listen, have several seats. Sit down. Laodicea thought they had everything, but they were so wrong. They were ignorant, and ignorant means unaware, and they were unaware of their true spiritual condition. They lacked self-awareness. Too many of us lack self-awareness. And as a result, they were apathetic in their relationship with God. Laodicea lost their love for Jesus and found themselves denying Jesus' lordship. There are so many professed Christians who think they're spiritually rich when actually they are bankrupt. They think they're beautiful when they're wretched. They think they need to be envied, but really they need to be pitied. They think they see everything clearly when they see nothing and are stone blind. They think they're clothed, but they're really naked. The church in Laodicea is proud. They're rich, they're prosperous, they're self-sufficient in their own eyes, but to Jesus, in Jesus' eyes, they're poor, they're blind, and they're naked. There are too many churches who are out there today trying to thrive on their own accomplishments. But you better believe that all that I am or ever will be is by the grace of God. All that you are or you ever will be is by the grace of God. Grace woke me up this morning. Grace started me on my way. Too many churches, too many Laodiceans are thriving on what they feel are their own accomplishments. They have a packed house, but they're spiritually empty. They have money in the bank, but they're spiritually bankrupt. They're known for their singing, but they're spiritually silent. They're clothed in fine clothing, but they're spiritually naked. They're preaching in the pulpit, but they're sounding brass and tinkling cymbal. They have their name on a marquee sign, but their names are not in the Lamb's Book of Life. They're indifferent, they're arrogant, and they are ignorant. And Jesus says, this church makes me sick, and I will spit them out. I will vomit them out. In verses 15, 16, and 17 of Revelation chapter 3, Jesus has addressed the problems of indifference, the problem of arrogance, the problem of ignorance. But now in verse 18, he offers a solution. He says, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich in white raiment, and thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness does not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. I'm almost done. But here Jesus tells the Laodiceans, after he's told them about themselves, he tells them three things. He tells them three areas where they need to invest. Number one, he says, invest in those things that are eternal. Invest in those things that will last. Buy gold that's been tried in the fire. Physically, they were rich and increased with goods, but they hadn't invested in the Lord. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 6, verse 20, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. Friends of mine, we are living in a culture today that is spiritually bankrupt. Many may be financially secure, but they are lacking in Christ. What good, my friends, will wealth, what good will homes and land do for our souls at the judgment? What shall it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his own soul? That's why you can do what you want to do, but choose you this day whom you're going to serve. But as for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. Invest in permanent eternal things. But number two, Jesus says, invest in the right garment. Invest in the right clothes. He says, buy white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness does not appear. Now, throughout Revelation, white garments symbolize those who are justified through faith in Christ and have confirmed their salvation. We say it all the time. When we get to heaven, when we get to the kingdom, I'm going to put on my robe. I'm going to tell the story how I made it over. But Jesus also in the text speaks of covering our shame. Because back in the day, the greatest humiliation was to be stripped naked. It started with Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. After they sinned, they needed a covering. The greatest humiliation back in the day was to be stripped naked, whereas the greatest honor was to be dressed in the finest clothes. God says, I want to put a long white robe on you. But then number three, Jesus says, invest not only in eternal things, invest not only in the right garments, but Jesus says, invest in the right ointment. Jesus says, anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thou mayest see. Jesus tells the Laodiceans to purchase eye salve. Now, this works out good because remember now, Laodicea, they had an eye salve that was known to cure blindness. Jesus tells them to purchase the right eye salve. The Laodiceans had developed an eye salve that cured blindness, but it did not prevent the church from being spiritually blind. And many today are just like that. They're going through the motions. They know the language, but they're blind to what is happening around them spiritually. We need to ask God to open our eyes that we might see. We need to see ourselves as we truly are. We need to see and have some self-awareness. We need to see this world as it truly is. We have lost our vision. And where there is no vision, the people perish. Helen Keller was asked, what could be worse than being born blind? She said, having sight with no vision. We need a vision for repentance, a vision for holy living, a vision for humble service, a vision for lost souls. There is far more to our relationship with Jesus Christ than just coming to church. There's a life to live and work to do outside the four walls of the church. But what I love about Jesus always gives hope. Even though this letter is harsh, it's tough, it's rough, it's condemning, there's also tenderness in the words of Jesus when we look at verse 19. He says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten, which means he chastens those whom he loves. So if Jesus ain't chastening you, there might be a problem. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and he says, repent. In other words, I'm going to get you told, but I still love you. I'm going to get you told, but you still need to repent. But then we come to verse 20, almost done, which is probably one of the most well-known verses in the book of Revelation. The word of God says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but when I was a little boy and I used to see those nice slides of Jesus, I love the picture of Jesus standing outside of a door and waiting to come into the heart of whoever is on the other side. Do I have a witness in this place? Jesus is standing and knocking. And these verbs are in the present tense, meaning continuous action, which means Jesus continues to stand and continues to knock on our hearts today. Let me close this way. A man and a woman were riding in an airport shuttle one morning on a shuttle from New York City to Washington, D.C. They were leaving Kennedy in New York, going to Reagan National in Washington, D.C. And all of a sudden, their eyes locked in to one another. Their eyes caught one another. Sparks flew. Something in their soul made them move. And they would like to say it was love at first sight. Now you need to know, they didn't know the other person. They didn't know each other. And there were no words exchanged as they stood together in the taxi line after they had arrived in D.C. at National Airport. The lady got in a cab. She got in a taxi. She looked back and she saw this man running after her and running after the taxi. The lady says to the cab driver, the taxi driver says, stop, stop, please stop, please stop. But the taxi driver kept going. So in desperation, she grabs a piece of paper and she scribbles her phone number on that paper. And she presses that paper up against the back window of the taxi. But sadly, the man was too far to read it. The lady kept in her riding her taxi. She went to her meeting that she had come for the day. But she couldn't stop thinking about that man. That man was on her mind. So she acted like she was sick. And she went back to the airport, left her meeting, to wait for him to see if she would see him. Because she knew they both had to catch the shuttle bus that evening back to New York. This lady waited all day in the airport lobby area at National. But he didn't show. The man was nowhere to be seen. Sadly and disappointed, the lady said, I'll just get on the shuttle and head back to New York. So she goes through airport security, takes her shoes off, goes through the metal detectors, but then she steps into the gate area. And to her joyful surprise, that man that she was looking for was in the gate area. He looked up at this lady and he said, what took you so long? I've been waiting all day long. The couple eventually got married and lived a life happily ever after. And Jesus is just like that man who was sitting waiting at that gate for that woman. In his great love, he waits for us as long as it takes. He wants us to enjoy relationship with him, but it won't happen unless we respond to him. Somebody watching today, I don't know who you are, I don't know where you are, but God told me to tell you that he's been waiting for you all day. In fact, he's been waiting for you all week, all month. He's been waiting for somebody all year. He's been standing at your door, knocking. Why? He doesn't want you to die lost. He's not willing that any should perish. But Jesus never goes where Jesus is not invited. But what I love about the text is, it says that when Jesus knocks at that door, and we open up the door, look what happens. The text says that Jesus says, if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, hallelujah, I will come in to him and I will sup with him and I will be with him and they will be with me. And then he goes on in the text and he says, I will grant them the privilege to sit with me in my throne. I will grant them the privilege to sit at the right hand of the Father. Which means, friends of mine, if we just open the door, we will be with Jesus and Jesus will be with us. If we just open the door, the wicked will cease from troubling and the weary will be at rest. If we just open the door, demons will be rebuked and angels will come and minister to us. If we just open the door, we will be a new creature. Old things will be passed away. All things will become new. If we just open the door and confess our sins, Jesus will forgive our sins, cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we just open the door, we will see Jesus and we will never be the same again. I plead with you, don't be indifferent. Don't be arrogant. Don't be ignorant. But invest in eternity. Invest in the right raiment, our long white robe. Invest in the right eye salve so you can see Jesus. Let me tell you this. I'm done. Whether you go to church or not, whether you've been in the church or not, and you may have been a part of the Laodicean lukewarm church, Jesus is standing at your door right now, and he's knocking. He's standing at the door of your heart, and he wants to know, are you going to open the door? Are you going to let him in? I'm a witness that when Jesus knocks at your door and you open that door and you let him in, I'm a witness that your life will never be the same again. Somebody say, oh, Pastor Bert, what are you talking about? You've been in the church all your life. You were born in the church. You grew up in the church. But I haven't always given my life to Jesus. It's one thing to be in the church, but it's another thing to be in Jesus. Jesus is knocking. He's knocking at the door of your heart. Today, will you let him in? For somebody, he's been knocking all night long. For somebody else, he's been knocking ever since last Sabbath. For somebody else, he's been knocking since last month. For somebody else, he's allowed COVID-19 because he's been knocking for the past 3 months in your life. For somebody else, he's been knocking for years. But God sent this message to you today.